Greetings and welcome to the Homeless Consultant channel. My name is Paul B. I am the Homeless Consultant. In this video, I'm going to tie up a loose end. One of my favorite people on Twitter made me aware that I've never made a video specifically about the time that I was denied my right to vote because I'm homeless back in the general election on November 8, 2016. So I'm going to talk about that here, and I honestly don't know how long it will take because there's a lot of sub-points that you have to understand why this is such a gross injustice. So I'm going to tell you the story, give you a slight amount of background, and then I'm going to have one brief digression that is very important for you to understand why nobody who you would expect to come to my aid in this came to my aid in this. So let's jump right in here. Before I tell you the story, I'll just give you a little preliminary here. Since I turned age 18, I have voted in every election that's come about. I ran for public office 20 years ago. Due to my upbringing and my ancestry and, things like Cub Scouts, and frankly, back when I was in school, they did a good job of teaching civics. So I have a strong sense of civic responsibility. I take my right to vote very, very seriously. Not so much because of the candidates, because there's a wonderful candidate I want to win so badly, but because I understand how hard people fought and died, including my ancestors, to give me that right, and I cherish it. And when someone like the state of Minnesota takes it away from me, I get really, really angry. So I apologize in advance if I come across as angry in this video, but there's a reason for it. I should also mention, just for the record, there is nothing to prevent or prohibit me from voting in the United States of America. I am a U.S. born citizen. Like I said, I've always voted before. I've never even been arrested, let alone tried or convicted of anything. There is absolutely no reason why I should be denied my right to vote. Now, again, there's a little bit of background so you understand what's happening. When I moved to Minnesota 10 years ago, I ended up living north of Minneapolis. And that was in Ramsey County, kind of curls around up there. Ramsey County is actually where St. Paul is of the Twin Cities, but it curls around. So technically, I was in Ramsey County. That's where I voted all the times that I lived up there. And again, I don't want to get into details of why I became homeless here anyway, but there's a few parts of it that are relevant. The immediate reason I lost my place to live was what you would call a constructive eviction. There was absolutely no grounds of, there weren't even the illusion of grounds for legally evicting me. I was the best tenant a person could ever hope to have. The problem were my neighbors. My neighbors were terrorizing me, absolutely terrorizing me, making my life a living hell, making it impossible for me to do my job at work. The landlord did not want to deal with that, so what he did was he contributed to making my life a living hell even more, to inspire me to move away. That's called a constructive eviction. It's illegal, it's immoral. As you're going to see in this video, if Minnesota was not comprised mainly of lazy bums who don't do their jobs, I should have had no problem whatsoever finding an attorney to litigate that, because what was done to me was criminal, what my landlord did. So when I left that community, I moved all of my stuff into a storage area south of Minneapolis. And the reason I did that is because I wanted to leave Minnesota, and believe me, I still do. Now, I've never been able to do that for various reasons, but that was the original goal. Since I've been homeless, the first several months, about 7 to 9 months, I'm not sure, I was in a hotel, and I lost a ton of my money by attrition in that hotel because I kept expecting somebody in the state of Minnesota to do their job. What happened with me was just so wrong in every way. There were government agencies that should have stood up for me. There were individuals, elected officials who should have stood up for me, attorneys. I had no reason to expect that I was not going to get some kind of justice and satisfaction. And I was absolutely horrified in the end when I found again that nobody in the state of Minnesota seems to do their jobs. They're just lazy bums, which is the polar opposite of how I was raised to be. Again, if you look at past videos, you'll see that one reason it was hard for me to function properly is because I worked so hard at my corporate job. And ironically, one of the things I did that kept me there so far past the 8 hours that I was paid on salary is that by the end I was receiving, you know, 80 to 120 emails every single day. More on Monday because they come in on the weekend. And I answered every single email before I left. That's a responsible thing to do. And what you're going to find here is that nobody in the state of Minnesota has responded to my emails. They don't. They don't do their jobs, but they accept a paycheck, and that's going to be one of the themes here. So when I was in that hotel, that's when my driver's license came up for renewal. So I renewed my driver's license using that hotel's address. I renewed the license plate tags on my car using that address. But shortly thereafter, I had no money left to do that, and I couldn't stay in the hotel anymore. That's when I began living in the car. So the background there is to tell you that I have a valid ID, a valid driver's license. My license plates and everything are current. They expire in a couple months. But they're based on a hotel in the area, in the same precinct where I tried to vote, and the same precinct where I had been sleeping out in my car. And that's very relevant when I tell you this story. So I think that's enough background. Let me tell you what happened on November 8. Prior to November 8, I had been looking for the how I'm supposed to register to vote when I'm homeless, because obviously I was not going to go vote north of the Twin Cities where I was still registered. One thing about Minnesota is that their government websites create a solid cast iron firewall between you and them. It is so hard to talk to an actual individual, especially if you don't have a phone, but to try to get a hold of an actual individual. They never respond to their emails. Again, they don't do anything. It's the laziest group of people I've ever seen in my life. And you can waste a tremendous amount of time and resources trying to contact these people to get some kind of an answer to anything. What I was able to find was that you are allowed to register to vote on the day of the election at the polling place. Now, because I'm a citizen in good standing, I have a current ID, I have my social security card, I even have a passport, although it's expired slightly, but it is a passport, shouldn't be a problem for me to register to vote on the day of the election. So that's what I chose to do. There was no reason not to. So on the morning, and I vote early if I'm able, and unfortunately, living in the car, unemployed, I'm able. I went to the polling place early, about 10:30 or something, and I went in to fill out the registration form first. And here's where you start to meet the absurdities. It's the same problem I have getting a job. It's the same problem I had getting unemployment insurance compensation, even though I was eligible for thousands upon thousands of dollars. These forms, like the registration form, they ask for your name and then they ask for your permanent resident address. But the thing is, most people don't read fine print. They hit, you know, they just hit, I've read the terms of service on websites all the time, but they don't read them. Well, I read them. And at the bottom of this registration form, it says, under penalty of perjury, a felony, I certify that all information on this registration form is true and correct to the best of my knowledge. Well, what is true and correct in reality is that I have no permanent resident address. So it is impossible for me to fill out that box for the resident address. Anything I put in there, I'm committing perjury, a felony. That's the problem. It's the same problem I had with unemployment insurance compensation. Even though I'm eligible for thousands and thousands of dollars, I would be committing a crime if I put any address in that box because it's not my permanent resident address. It isn't. I don't have one. And this is where Minnesota state legislators are so out of touch with reality. They never, like with this rotating shelter I've been with for the last month, No legislator came to talk to us. They don't even comprehend that the laws they've put in place legally prohibit us. If we're going to obey the law, well, we can't. I mean, the only way we can obey the law is to never get any services, never register to vote, never register our car, never get a driver's license. The only way we can comply with the law is to die. There's nothing else we can do legally. Most people just break the law. Most people just violate the law. And that's where I have to backtrack slightly, because people will say, well, why don't you just break the law? Well, A, I was brought up not to break the law. I was brought up to be honest. And if someone else puts these legal obstacles in my way, my job is to fight that and to get the laws changed so that nobody is put in this Hobson's choice situation. A Hobson's choice is where you're given two options and they're both equally reprehensible. I mean, you can't win. Damned if you do, damned if you don't. And that's exactly the situation I'm in with things like getting unemployment insurance, applying for a job at most places, any place that has a disclaimer at the bottom saying, I certify this information is true and correct. But you also have to understand that one reason I'm homeless, one reason the government did nothing to help me, is because this government doesn't like me. Now, I'm not saying they have my picture up on their walls. I'm not saying a lot of these people even know my name. Probably very few of them do. However, I have fought against government corruption since I got to Minnesota. But when I moved to Minnesota, I became stranded here because I was ending a 10-year project where I had been traveling the United States of America, studying the political and social climate in all of the U.S. states that I could reach, which was most of them. And I can say with certainty and with authority, Minnesota has about the most corrupt, incompetent, negligent government, state government that I have seen. Closest thing to it might be the Chicago machine, which is descended all the way from Al Capone era. New York is also horrific, but I did not go to New York to study that in detail. Minnesota's the worst I've actually seen. Certainly the worst I've lived in, there isn't even a comparison. They're like two different universes. Everywhere else I've lived, and then Minnesota. The incompetence and the negligence here is shocking. Now, I fought against that, and one of the things I fought against in particular is called racketeering. And I want to give you a quick idea of what racketeering is, because what you're going to find is that when they made it impossible for me to vote, they were engaging in the exact same racketeering that I was trying to fix in this government, which helped me to become homeless in the first place. You can kind of see where all this builds on each other. Classic racketeering. Let's say you own a delicatessen. It's your family business. It's your life. You love it. You're building your business and a reputation. Everything's fine. It's a fairly low crime district, and you're just doing business. One day, Rocco walks into your deli with a baseball bat in one hand and a can of gasoline in the other. And Rocco offers to sell you protection. If you give him money, he will protect you from people vandalizing or burning to the ground your business. That is classic racketeering, and here's why. Because he is providing both the supply and the demand. Before Rocco came in there, none of this existed. Didn't even impact you. He created the supply and the demand. Now, to show you just how much all of this ties together, if you look at my videos on YouTube, the first videos I put on this channel were a business series called How Not to Do Business. And I had a 5-part introduction, and then I launched into the actual business videos. The very first video on business was called The Law of Supply and Demand. You see, all of this ties together. When people artificially manipulate the law of supply and demand, it's usually a criminal act. If nothing else, it undermines the law of supply and demand, which undermines our economy and people's ability to do business. But when you create both the supply and the demand, it is criminal racketeering. In the Al Capone sense. That's what the state government keeps doing over and over and over again. That's what I've been fighting against. So understand what racketeering is, first of all. Now, the RICO laws, you know, which are supposedly put in place to fight racketeering through the legal system, they have been put in place in many cases to deal with the drug war, and therefore they are corrupted, they are used against people who are innocent. The RICO laws themselves have become a weapon instead of a tool, and this happens all too often in our legal system. So I'm not talking about things within RICO necessarily. I'm talking about classic racketeering. I'm talking about Rocco with a baseball bat and a can of gasoline. That's the way the Minnesota State Legislature operates, and they do it all the time. It's instinctive for them. I'm not even sure these people understand that what they're doing is racketeering. They operate like a cult. If you're an outsider, they're going to put you in these positions where you cannot win, and that's racketeering. All right. So when I went to register to vote and I saw that at the bottom where I had to certify that all information was correct and I could not comply, it's impossible. I don't have a permanent address. So I talked to the people who work there and I asked them what I'm supposed to do, and they had absolutely no idea. They're used to people coming in, voting, leaving. Maybe coming in, filling out the registration form, voting, and leaving. And this, again, goes back into the general incompetence of Minnesota. Dealing with things that they're not used to dealing with is not their strong point. They're not good at going out and researching information, finding answers. They expect everything to go nice and smooth, and if there's anyone throws a monkey wrench in there, they don't know what to do. Now, I am going to say, in this case, the people at the polling place were very nice to me. They were very understanding, and they did their best to help. And I'm very grateful for that. In particular, there was a woman named Anne, and Anne was very, very helpful. She tried everything she could to get me to vote, and I'm very grateful to her. One of the things she did was she put me on her telephone speaking to Dakota County, and that's the county that this precinct was in. Remember, the precinct I was in, where the polling place was, is where I had been sleeping for the last several weeks, and it's where my driver's license address is because that's where the hotel is. So it's all in a nice package there. It should have been a piece of cake for me to get registered if this perjury law had not been put on this registration form. So when I talked to the county on the phone, excuse me, it's very cold. I'm going to have to clear my throat. It's hard to talk when it's this cold. When I spoke to the county on the phone, they were helpful, but it was more traditional Minnesota help, which is characterized by the phrase, "I'm sorry, there's nothing I can do." I have heard that phrase so many times, I should have a t-shirt that said it. When I spoke to the person from the county, and I recorded it, and I'm going to play bits of it for you later at the end of this. Now, I didn't record the call. What I did was I had the recorder with me so you can hear what I'm saying. You can't hear what the person on the other end of the phone is saying. I didn't record the phone call. I recorded the ambient noise where I was making a phone call. So because I was doing that, I made a point of repeating what they said when they said something significant to confirm it. And that way you can hear me say something like, "Okay, so what you just said is correct? Okay." So that way you know that's what they said on the other end of the line. And what they basically said was, the only way if you're homeless you can register to vote is if you have somebody who lives in this precinct, and possibly they have to be registered to vote. I'm not sure about that, but they have to live in that precinct, and they have to vouch for you that you slept in this precinct the previous night. Just that one night. I had slept there for several weeks at that point. Now here's the problem, and this is what I told the person on the phone. When you're homeless, you don't advertise the fact that you're sleeping out in a parking lot somewhere, because that's a good way to become dead. That's a good way to be robbed. It's a good way to be carjacked. It's a good way to be messed with. Look at my videos on this channel. A whole bunch of them keep saying things like lazy employed and hardworking unemployed. Creepy headlight stalkers. A lot of my videos are making the point over and over and over again, and I'm proving it with video, that I'm not the threat as a homeless person. It's the people out there who are a threat to me. And I've talked about homeless against the violence. I've shared documents put together by various organizations that talk about violence against the homeless, criminalization of homelessness. I have repeatedly talked about how I am the one at risk living in this car, not those people out there. So the last thing I'm going to do when I'm sleeping in a parking lot, especially if I don't know I need to do it to vote, because there's no rational reason I should have to do it to vote, but the last thing I'm going to do is put a bunch of flags on my car so they're blowing in this cold breeze that blows through my car every night. I'm not going to stick a disco ball up on top to shine and boom, 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 draw attention to myself so that I can have somebody witness that I slept here. What I'm going to do is hide back in the dark. I'm going to try to stay quiet, stay out of everyone's way, not draw attention to myself the best of my ability. That's exactly what I do. Now, I told the person on the phone there from the county, the police here in this community know me very well. I talk to them all the time. They know about my YouTube channel. I went in and introduced myself to the police chief. They know me quite well. And they said, well, if their members... If they live in this precinct, they can vouch for you if they saw you sleep in there last night. And it's like, well, I was asleep. I don't know if they did or not. How am I supposed to know that? I mean, there's no way to facilitate this, in other words. So at that point, I realized I can't vote. I'm not allowed to vote. Because, again, the Minnesota legislators are completely out of touch with reality, and they never ever respond to my emails. The only thing I've got in terms of a response, and I've said this before too, I emailed every single legislator, all 200 of them, individually so it wouldn't be spam. The two responses I got, one of them asked for my permanent home address so that he could send the response there. And that was either complete incompetence on his part because he didn't even bother reading what I'd written, or it was just as possibly a snide way of mocking me. The other one just wrote back, Julie Rosen, she just wrote back, no thank you. Those are the only responses I've ever had from legislators. Throughout this rotating shelter deal I've been participating in, no legislators have shown up to meet us or to hear what our lives are like being homeless, such as things like this. So how are they going to know? They don't care. I've said it all along. This legislature doesn't care if the homeless live or die, as long as it's done off camera so that they never are held accountable for it. They're lazy bums. And you would think if they just, when they sat down and passed these laws, you would think they'd scratch their head and show some critical thinking skills and a little foresight and say, well, let's see, if you're homeless, how are you going to have somebody vouch for where you slept the night before when the homeless are sleeping under bridges and in swamps and in cars? They're the least likely people to have someone able to vouch for them. You would think they would you know, run the numbers and think about the facts a bit, and they would come up with the obvious answer. And clearly, they just don't care. That's the reason these laws are in place. For me to have someone vouch for me, here's what I would have had to done. I would have to have a phone, first of all, which I didn't. And at some point in the middle of the night, I would have to call up someone who lives in this precinct. I would have to say, hey, do you mind getting up and getting dressed, coming out to my car, and then standing by my car for however long it takes for me to fall asleep? And I don't know how you prove that I'm asleep. Maybe you can hear me snoring or something. And then when that finally happens, you can go back home and go back to sleep. And then tomorrow I'm going to call you up and have you come down to the precinct and sign a form certifying that you witnessed me sleeping the night before. That's what I would have to do to have someone vouch for me. And that's what someone living under a bridge would have to do, and someone living in a swamp would have to do. These legislators don't care if we live or die. That's why I fought this negligence, incompetence, and corruption for so many years. That's what helped me to become homeless. Now that I'm homeless, the same people who put me in this situation, who contributed so much to putting me in this homeless situation, have created laws that prohibit me logically from doing what you need to do to be able to register to vote. And that means I cannot vote against them. I can't vote them out of office so that they can never hurt anybody ever again. Do you recognize what I just described? It's Rocco with the baseball bat and the can of gasoline. They created the supply and the demand for this. It's racketeering. It's classic criminal racketeering. It's no different than what Al Capone did. They put me in this situation through their own negligence, their own refusal to do the job that they accept a paycheck for. That's what put me in this situation. And then when I'm in this situation, they create the laws that say you have to do this and it's the only way you can vote against us. But it's logically impossible for me to do that. It's racketeering. Now, the reason I make that point is because you would think people would care about this. You'd think like the media would care and election watchdog groups. You would think attorneys would care because look at the lawsuit potential here. You would think somebody somewhere would care. And what you're going to find in this story is that nobody cared. Nobody. So after I got off the phone with the county, and one of the things I asked the county before I got off the phone, I asked them, okay, you're saying I need to have someone vouch for where I slept last night. All these people I see coming in here who take 5 minutes, there's no line. They come in, they vote, and they leave. How do you verify their address? How do you verify that they're telling the truth? And the answer I got was, we don't verify it. We assume they're telling the truth. So I said, okay, let me get this straight. I walk in here and up front, voluntarily, I'm honest with you. I tell you the truth honestly. You didn't even ask me to. I just did it because it's the right thing to do. And I asked you how to comply with the laws so that I could vote. And you're telling me I can't vote. But all these people, you assume they're telling the truth and no one even bothers to verify it. And they said, yes, that's exactly the case. So they admitted up front that it's just a completely absurd, upside-down, stupid, unjust system. But when I asked them, I said, well, isn't it your moral obligation, and in fact, in many cases, it's your legal obligation to defy immoral laws. You're supposed to break those laws and then let them be litigated. That's how you get rid of junk laws like this. But they wouldn't even go there. Because, again, they're not the ones who fight against corruption and incompetence and negligence. They're the ones who let people like me do it on their behalf to protect them from domestic enemies like this Minnesota legislature. But because nobody ever stood up for me when I did that, I'm the one who got my head cut off. I might as well have been, you know, trying to convert people to Christianity in Tehran. Because I got essentially the same result here in Minnesota when nobody stood up for me. They wanted me to do it because they want somebody to stand up for these things that hurt them so badly, but they wouldn't stand up with me. They let me get my head cut off by this legislature just like I would get it cut off in Iran. And that's what this person on the phone from the county was saying. I'm not going to violate the law. I'm not going to put my head on the block just to make sure you have your right to vote. That's essentially what they said. In other words, what they said was, I'm a completely irresponsible citizen. I'm not going to stand up for anything or anybody except myself. Now, of course, they didn't say it that way, but that is exactly what they were saying in as many words. When I got off the phone, I then asked them, what am I supposed to do now? And they said, well, we have these complaint forms you can fill out, and the election judge on election day has the power of notary. And you have to have the forms notarized. So I filled out the forms, and I didn't have my glasses, so it's like all slanted, you know, handwriting. And then I copied it over to the other form. I'm not entirely sure what they were. They couldn't even tell me. These judges probably never have anybody fill these complaints out. And they couldn't even tell me what these were for, but it was something to do with the state. And the other one, I believe, was some kind of independent watchdog group, but it's done through the state. Even I don't, no one could tell me what they were. But I filled both of them out. I asked them for permission and they granted it. I took these out to this car in the parking lot, got out my camera and photographed them. I took them inside. I went to the election judge. I sat down with him. He read both of them carefully. We conversed about it briefly so I could explain it. And then he signed it. He notarized them. And then he took those forms, and presumably he filed them where they need to be filed. That's his job. as the election judge. And I saw nothing in him that made it look like he was going to do anything other than what he thought was proper with these forms. Now, when I left, I've said in another video what it's like to live in a car. I was in shock. I was in shock as if I had just been in a plane crash and survived. I was denied my right to vote in the United States of America, in the state of Minnesota in the 21st century. And nobody could do anything about it. So the next thing I did was I contacted the media. I wrote a little blurb explaining what had happened, how to contact me for more information. I sent it to KSTP. Let me get out. If I can find my glasses here. I sent it to KSTP. I believe I sent it to CARE 11. I definitely sent it to MPR, Minnesota Public Radio. All three of these organizations have never once ever responded to me. Ever. Throughout all of this years I've been dealing with why I became homeless, what it's like being homeless, how the law essentially prevents me from getting out of homelessness unless I break another law in the process, which is what all these other homeless people do. The thing is, they didn't fight against a corrupt government, did they? I'm the one who will get audited if I break those laws, not these guys who are out there drinking booze and shooting up heroin in their arm all day. That's why they get away with lying. That's why they get away with collecting unemployment insurance and calling it a year-long paid vacation. That's why they get away with getting food stamps while they have all this jewelry and a fur coat and they're driving around in a new car living in government housing. Because they're willing to lie and nobody's going to audit them. No one's going to go after them because they never went after this corrupt government. I did. That's why I can't do anything. I'm completely immobilized in a legal sense. So I wrote to these media in Minnesota, and the media in Minnesota protects the government. That's all they do. At this rotating shelter about a month ago, I was interviewed by the big newspaper here, the Star Tribune. They talked to some other people. They, as far as I know, they spent the most time with me. I showed them my videos. I'm quite articulate. I explained everything. But can you believe it? All it takes is going to my videos and I quickly realize I'm exposing how rotten this state government really is. So they put everyone else in the story, but they left me out of it completely. Even though I was the most articulate, even though I'm the one creating these videos that demonstrates what I'm talking about, proof, evidence, proof, legal evidence, proof, and yet they just completely ignored me as if I didn't exist. That's because they protect this government. I also wrote to Ramsey County. That's the county where I lived all those years when I moved to Minnesota, where I voted previously. I sent them an email and I said, I want you to cancel my registration and ensure that nobody votes in my name today because I can't get there to vote. I don't live there anymore. I will not be there to vote. So I want you to cancel the registration, make sure nobody votes, and I want you to confirm back to me that you've done so. I also contacted Election Protection. Their website is 866ourvote.org. And this is one of these watchdog groups that is supposed to try, they claim to be ensuring fair elections. And I'm going to have a word to say about these kinds of people a little later. It's very, very important because if you don't understand why I never heard back from these guys, you're not going to understand what they're really doing. And it goes right back to what I said before, laziness. People who accept paychecks, but they don't do their jobs. Instead, in this case, they're doing something other than what their mission states. They have their own agenda, and I'm going to talk about that in a moment. Lastly, I wrote to the National Coalition for the Homeless, and I told them that I had been denied my right to vote because I'm homeless. Now, here's the thing. As of today, it has been 76 days since the election, 76 days since I contacted all these people. So my outbox has all these emails going out to the Ramsey County and the media and the National Coalition of the Homeless, all this. Let's see what my responses were. Oh, no response. Empty inbox. How about that? Wow. No response from Ramsey County. They did not do their job. They accepted a paycheck for doing their job, but they never responded back and confirmed, as I asked them to do, confirmed to me that my registration in Ramsey County was canceled and nobody voted under my name. They accepted a paycheck, though. Lazy bums. On those two notarized complaints that I submitted to the state through the election judge, no response, nothing. Absolutely nothing. Somebody's accepting a paycheck somewhere, but they're not doing their jobs. Lazy bums. All of the media I contacted. You would think, oh, let's see, a homeless person is denied their right to vote in the 21st century United States of America. You'd think that's newsworthy, but to KSTP, Care 11, NPR, and later on when I told the Star Tribune about it, wasn't noteworthy at all. Somebody is accepting a paycheck to supposedly be the media who tells the people about things like this, but they didn't do anything. Lazy bums, and in this case, corrupt lazy bums. They're protecting a corrupt government, an incompetent, negligent, and corrupt government. See, who else did I contact? This election protection, which is affiliated with a group called the Lawyers Committee. Now, have you ever heard of a lawyer working for free when they don't have to? You know, they have to do a certain amount of pro bono work, but have you ever heard of them just doing it out of the goodness of their heart? It's possible, but for the most part, lawyers accept a paycheck, don't you think? The Lawyers Committee that runs election protection, not a word from them. Election protection, they were told that somebody had been denied their right to vote because they're homeless. Not a word. Not only that, but I went and I looked at their summary that came out, their published summary of the complaints they received in early December. They didn't even mention that the homeless were denied their right to vote in the state of Minnesota. And I want to point out right when I just want to point this out for future reference. Minnesota is one of the most liberal states in the country. And that's important when you're going to find out why groups like this did not publish the fact that Minnesota is prohibiting the homeless or making it impossible for them to vote without breaking the law. Not to say some homeless people didn't vote, they just had to break the law when they did so by certifying that wrong address. But I did receive one email. It was an autoresponder from the Lawyers Committee when I first wrote to them. It just bounced back within seconds and said, we've received your email, blah, blah, blah. So I know that they got it, but in their published report, nothing, silence. And Minnesota's a liberal state. Keep that in mind. It becomes important. National Coalition for the Homeless, they have never once ever responded to me on any email I've ever sent them. If I could take a big eraser and just erase the National Coalition for the Homeless, I would. They are useless. And if you support them, you're a sucker. Not a word. They were told a homeless person was denied the right to vote. Not even a response. So my point is, through all of this, nobody anywhere responded. Yet me, the homeless guy, the lazy bum, right? I'm the lazy bum. I must be, because I'm homeless, right? You can't become homeless unless you're a lazy bum, right? Or a drunk or something. I spent more than an hour in the polling place while everyone who voted took about 5 minutes each. I filled out these forms and got them notarized. I spent 13 minutes on the phone with the county investigating the matter. I went and contacted the media and election protection and Ramsey County. I contacted the National Coalition for the Homeless. The better part of that day was spent dealing with this for me. I got zero pay for that. All of these people who didn't respond, didn't do anything, accepted a paycheck. Who is the lazy bum? That's my question. Maybe now you understand why I'm so angry about this. So what we're dealing with on the one hand is criminal racketeering among the Minnesota legislature. They create the conditions through their own negligence, their failure to protect and defend citizens to enforce their own laws, which is what they did in my case. Laws that they themselves passed, but they refused to enforce them for me. They would do it for their friends, but they wouldn't do it for me. It's called selective enforcement of the law, and it's sickening. It's reprehensible, and it destroyed my life. They put me in this situation, and then they also created the laws that said there's no way I can vote unless I commit perjury doing it. That is criminal racketeering. You would think election protection or the media or National Coalition for the Homeless might be interested in a documented case of the Minnesota legislature engaging in criminal racketeering. But they're lazy bums. Nobody cared. Now, I'm going to make this one digression here, and I have to put my glasses on for it. I want to talk again about these groups that claim to be defending the integrity of elections, like election protection. Now, election protection also protects itself. I couldn't really find any good information on who the world they even are. I could have looked more in depth, but I found another group right away that was easy to research, so I went with that instead. But they're all really the same thing. The point I want to make, and this is an important point, not just for my situation, but for yours as a citizen, as a voter. I went to another group that does the same thing. They're called fairvote.org. And you can go to their website. All of these groups have missions, stated missions, much like these mega churches in Minnesota have stated missions. We follow the Holy Bible. Okay, but then when it comes to helping the homeless, they just leave them out to die, even though the Bible throughout says, don't do that. You help the homeless, you help the poor, you help the widows, you help the orphans. That's how you prove that you're truly sincere about your faith, and that sincere faith is what gets you into heaven. Okay, so these mega churches have these stated missions, but they don't do anything. So it's the same thing with these groups like fairvote.org and election protection. They always, in their missions, they always call themselves nonpartisan. Nonpartisan means that it is not leaning in a political direction. It's not leaning to the left, it's not leaning to the right, it's not leaning toward libertarian. It's supposedly objective, and the only way I can even think of that that's possible is if you had a large group of people that was represented by the left and the right and moderates and, you know, socialists and communists and libertarians and this, that, and the other thing, and Whigs. I don't know how you can have anything be nonpartisan. I think that word's a bunch of baloney in the first place, but let's give them the benefit of the doubt. So let's look at the board of directors for Fairvote, because it took me about, 10 or 20 seconds for each and every member that I could find information on to determine just where they're coming from. Remember, these guys claim to be nonpartisan, ensuring the integrity of American elections. Their chair is named Christ, I'm not going to pronounce it the other way, Christ Novoselic. He was the bass player for the band Nirvana. He helped to create a political action committee called JAMPAC, which is Joint Artists and Musicians Political Action Committee. Let me ask you, now it doesn't say explicitly, but what do you think a political action committee that represents artists and musicians, do you think that's moderate, right down the middle, or do you think it might lean a little bit to the left? Just a little bit to the left. Personally, I think it falls completely to the left. I'm just guessing. In any event, you can't have a political action committee that is nonpartisan. A political action committee, by definition, is a lobbying group. They're lobbying for something, an ideology, an agenda. They have to lean one way or another. My guess is that it's liberal because it's all about artists and musicians. It doesn't say anything about country and Western musicians. Nirvana sure wasn't. My guess is it leans left. All right, let's move on. Next on the board of directors of fairvote.org, Hendrik Hertzberg. He wrote speeches for Jimmy Carter, Democrat. Forbes magazine named Hertzberg one of the 25 most influential liberals in the U.S. media. Left. Enough said. Next, Cynthia Terrell, a feminist. Very proud of the fact that she worked with Senator Tom Harkin, a Democrat, Iowa. Douglas Wilder, the governor of Virginia, a Democrat. And Congresswoman Jolene Unsold, a Democrat. leaning left. So far, are you seeing the nonpartisan aspect of this? Next person, William Redpath. From what I can tell, he's a libertarian. All right. The thing is, on certain issues, libertarians are the same, or effectively the same as liberals. But libertarian. Next, David Wilner, founder of Wind River Systems. Now, Sourcewatch is a bunch of crap. I mean, that's just meant to protect liberals right there. Sourcewatch does not mention his political slant, which tells you he's liberal. That's what Sourcewatch does. It tries to go after people on the right and make them look bad, and it just ignores all the horrific things that the left does. But either way, he lives in Berkeley, California. My guess is leans a little bit to the left. You don't start a business in Berkeley, California when you lean to the right. It doesn't make a lot of sense, does it? Next one, Katie Goes. She's British. Not even an American citizen. On the board of directors of fairvote.org, which is meant to ensure the integrity of American elections. She's a member of the Labor Party. Labor. Does that sound like a Democrat kind of thing or a Republican kind of thing? Works for human rights. Human rights groups are about everything except human rights. They're about a liberal agenda. And it's a shame, because there are a lot of human rights violations out there, but these people are not the ones who are fixing it any more than all these people who claim to be helping the homeless are helping the homeless. National Coalition for the Homeless, who didn't even respond. Leaning to the left. Next, Paul Jacob. It's hard to tell with him, but he appeared to be libertarian. So again, you can kind of think of it as in the middle, but on social issues, tends to lean left. Susanna Welford. She's obsessed, from what I can tell, with women's issues, women voting and such. That's her life. Left. Next is Mike Lind. I couldn't find any information on this fellow, and again, I was just taking 10 or 15, 20 seconds on each one, so I don't know. I don't know. Joe Swimmer. He's from San Francisco. Well, there you go. I mean, do I need to say anymore? Geographically, this group seems to zero in on the Seattle-San Francisco area. Is that a hotbed of right-wing conservatism? And he's associated with the Berkeley School of Law. Left. Lastly, John B. Anderson. A Republican. Wow. But he's a Republican fossil. Does anyone even remember John Anderson? He ran for president, I don't know, against Lincoln or Jefferson or something. If he's even still alive, I wouldn't doubt it's his corpse that they have on this thing. He's listed as emeritus, which basically means I'm putting my name on it, but I don't really have to do a whole lot. I don't really have to do anything. Just kind of lending my name to it. That's the Republican on this board of directors. That's their entire board of directors for this nonpartisan group that claims to worry about fair elections. Now, my question is for you. It doesn't matter which way I had planned to vote. What were the odds these guys were going to help me out if they knew I was going to vote right? If I was going to vote for Trump? What are the odds they're going to help me if they knew that? I'm just guessing here, but I think I'm going to be at the bottom of their list of people to help. Because they have a political agenda. Even though they call themselves nonpartisan. You see, that's the thing with liberals. They lie. They lie. They deceive. They use language games to misportray themselves all the time. That's why they say things like human rights when, in fact, they do something different. That's why they're always screaming tolerance when they're... You can't find anyone who's more intolerant. Look at all the protests right now against Trump. See, these groups that are supposedly the ones I'm supposed to go to with something like this, they almost all lean to the left. And the fact is, they don't care. If you look closely at these groups, they mention one other thing that gives away what they're really about. It's called... They're seeking fair representation is what they call it. I'll put that in quotes, fair representation. Now, to me, fair representation is that when everyone who is legally eligible to vote is able to vote, and all the people who are not eligible to vote are prevented from voting. To me, that's fair representation. That's the whole point of an election, isn't it? People vote. Whoever wins, wins. Now, you might have things like in America, we have an electoral college, so you can have someone win the popular vote and someone else is elected through the electoral college. And that's what happened in this case this year with Hillary Clinton winning the popular vote, Trump winning the electoral college. When you have a state, when you have a country with a state like California, where it has a massive population, but it isn't the majority of the country, I mean, these, you can't let California dictate policy for the rest of the country just because they have a huge population that leans to the left. That's what the Electoral College is there to prohibit. You can't do that. That's the opposite of democracy. So the Electoral College has a purpose. It's not perfect by any stretch of the imagination, but you know, the early founders went through an awful lot of effort to try to make it as fair as they could. What I'm getting at is that when these groups talk about fair representation, they're not talking about fair representation. If the election is fair, if everyone who's eligible to vote is allowed to vote, then the results are fair. That's what an election is. What they're saying is, we don't like the outcome of the election. There's too many Republicans who won. They don't represent us. They don't represent the people who we think are cool. So we're going to do things, we're going to pull all these shenanigans to try to ensure that, you know, more people who vote our way are able to vote, you know. So if you look at what they're really doing is they're only concerned with people who they think are going to vote Democrat or liberal. You know, poor people, I don't want to use the word immigrants because so many of them are illegal, they're criminals, they're not immigrants at all. My ancestors were immigrants, they went through the proper procedures, but that's who they're trying to, quote, help. And they say it's so that they'll be fairly represented. Well, you know what? They're fairly represented by Donald Trump, because that's who won the election according to our system, which uses the Electoral College. Enter me, a homeless person. You would think these liberals would be all about helping the homeless, right? A homeless person who comes out and contacts them and says, here's a case where I'm denied my right to vote because I'm homeless, and it's done in the context of criminal racketeering. You would think a group that truly cares about the integrity of elections would jump all over that, wouldn't ya? But they didn't. They didn't even respond. And the reason is because it's a farce. All of these groups are a farce. They lean so far to the left, the only concern they have is they're not trying to stop people who would vote conservative from voting. They're trying to do everything they can to make sure that as many of these people on the left vote as possible. And they don't care if they have to worry about redistricting or whatever. They're going to throw a monkey wrench in every way. They're trying to affect the outcome of the elections. They're not trying to, that's my point. They're trying to affect the outcome of the election. They are not trying to ensure that everyone who is eligible to vote is able to vote, and that all the people who are not eligible to vote are prohibited from voting. And the proof is right here. They didn't even respond. They accepted paychecks, but they didn't even respond when a homeless person told them they were denied their right to vote in the context of criminal racketeering in Minnesota. Enough said. This is what I'm up against. And this was just to vote in one election. This is the kind of nonsense I deal with when I'm trying to get a job, when I'm trying to get a shower, when I'm trying to get anything done, trying to get this car repaired, trying to come up with money for the $10 to $30 in gas I need every day, depending on the temperature. This is what it's like being homeless. So this isn't just about me not being able to vote, which sickens me. There should have been lawyers crawling out of the woodwork in Minnesota to represent me on this. And you know what? If they had, and I'd been able to sue these people in St. Paul, I could have sued them for damages, and I could have used those damages to get a place to live so that I can get a job, which is exactly, if you look through all my videos, all I've said all along is I want a job. I don't want government handouts. I don't want food stamps. I want a job. But the laws in Minnesota effectively prohibit me from getting a job unless I break another law doing it. And as I said before, what the other homeless people do is they just break the law. But I challenged negligence, incompetence, and corruption in St. Paul for so many years. I'm the one who will be audited if I break those laws. That's why I'm dying here in the state of Minnesota. And that's exactly the way the legislature wants it. The sooner I die off camera, because the media sure isn't covering this, as soon as I die off camera and get out of their hair and am forgotten about, the better. Again, I don't have some illusion that my picture's sitting on everyone's computer in St. Paul. Oh, we gotta watch out for this guy. I think most of them don't even know that I exist. It's a systemic problem. There's other people like me who are out there fighting corruption, and they encounter the same basic obstacles and absurdities and injustices, and nobody is standing up for us. These lawyers in this state should have been, it should have been like a Black Friday sale. These guys jumping over each other to get to me. My case is so strong. But instead, lawyers, have you ever seen a lawyer do anything for free? They're making money hand over fist, but they're lazy bums. A clear case of corruption, criminal racketeering, and nobody will stand up to help me. Lazy bums. The only person in this state who did anything on election day is the guy sleeping in this car. Look at how much effort I went through to try to vote or to try to get some kind of justice after I was denied my right to vote. And this is what I do every day in terms of trying to get a job, in terms of trying to work around these counterproductive shelters, working with these churches who accept tax-exempt status when they don't even do what their own Bible tells them to do. And in fact, they do a bunch of things that their Bible tells them not to do. I'm the guy fighting all this stuff. So that's the story of how I was denied my right to vote in the state of Minnesota in the 21st century. If this doesn't scream banana republic to you, I don't know what should. Please leave your comments, leave any questions, subscribe to this channel, like the video if you like what I had to say here, and I hope you'll think very carefully about what I said, because it's a small part of a huge problem that affects our elections. It's one of the reasons we have these people whining and moaning about Trump winning when they wouldn't have said a word if Hillary had won, and the other side wouldn't have said a word either. These people are not defending my right to vote. They claim to be. They're making money. They're out there asking for donations, supposedly to ensure the integrity of elections, but they don't care that I was denied my right to vote. Their agenda is to make sure that people who vote their way are able to vote. And that's just a whole nother bunch of corruption out there, isn't it? Okay, and the last thing I'm going to do is I'm going to end this video with a couple excerpts from that recording I made when I was talking to the elections judge. So it's going to be a recording of just what you hear from the outside from me. Because I repeat what they say, you're going to be able to understand what I'm talking about. And I'll just let that play out the end of this video. Thank you so much for watching. Okay, so the only way I can register to vote is to have a witness from someone in that precinct that saw me sleeping there last night. Last night or recently? There's a couple of the police officers know I'm out there, but they weren't there last night. True, I would have to find out. Okay, so just having a legal driver's license and social security number isn't enough to identify me as unique. So then as far as voting, am I just not allowed to vote as a U.S. citizen then? Or they just don't have a... Okay. Do any people who provide you with a home address, do they need someone to vouch for them, or do you just believe them? How do you know that their address is valid?
How do you know their address is valid but mine isn't? Other than the fact that I was honest with you and I told you and they don't tell you anything. You assume that it is. So basically, if somebody lies, they can vote, but me telling the truth, I'm not allowed to vote. That's what is correct. These people don't care if I really die. I would like an opportunity to get rid of them so they can't hurt other people ever again. Is there anyone I can go to who can... I don't like being penalized because of my situation. I do not advertise the fact that I'm sleeping in a parking lot. The point of sleeping there is to not be accosted by other people. I don't put a red flag up there saying, please witness my presence here. I say, please try to stay away and don't hurt me. Don't kill me while I'm sleeping. So I... What can I do? What can I do to exercise my right as a citizen? Okay. Okay. Wow. I don't know what to say. I never expected to have my citizenship franchise for no reason. I haven't committed any crime. I haven't done anything wrong. Okay, this is what I got for trying to protect you and everyone else out here from this government corruption here. This is what they did to me. I'm not drunk, I'm not insane. I was trying to protect you from a corrupt government. And off camera, they did this to me. I want to vote them out of office. Nobody helped me. People are sitting there watching me in a car, and now you're telling me I can't vote when I'm a U.S. citizen. I once ran for public office, ma'am. I would like to know how I can exercise my legal right to vote here and how you can consider these results valid if you do not allow a citizen to vote. If you can follow the law. But the law was created by the very people who made me homeless so that I cannot vote. You understand the problem with them. Would you be negligent if you disobeyed a immoral law? Or fought somehow? Can you call the press to get them out here to do something about it? Because they've never cared about my situation before. They protect this government. Would they come out here and fail at that? Can you do something like that? Is there anything you can do, or am I just not going to vote and have to accept the mandate, the vote results of people who didn't care whether I lived or died, including 5 million citizens of Minnesota? And I'm just so disgusted that I could be sick. All right. Bless you for your time. Apologize for any of yelling at you. I know it's not your fault. All right, here's Anne.